So I'm here on vacation, not my typical office, but I wanted to talk a little bit about an important subject that we're dealing with as we speak. That's the subject of measles. We've had a recent outbreak in the Western United States that really needs to be addressed. Vaccines are one of the most misunderstood and maligned parts of healthcare today, and we're going to talk about what measles is, why you should be worried about it, how we got into this mess, and what you can do about it. Welcome to Family Med, your medical home for practical and accurate information to help your family make healthy decisions. I'm Dr. Eric Richardson, and my passion is helping you cut through all the health information clutter on the internet. If that sounds like the kind of information you or your family needs, make sure you follow along with us. Hit that subscribe button and share it with your friends. Okay, so today we're talking about the measles, what it is, and why it is so important that we vaccinate for this. This is actually kind of a frustrating thing to have to talk about as a physician. In the year 2000, it was actually a disease that was declared eradicated in the United States by the Centers for Disease Control. But unfortunately, due to a lack of immunizations, we are seeing more and more outbreaks. See, measles is a highly infectious respiratory virus that is spread by cough and sneezing. In fact, it is so infectious that 9 out of 10 people who are exposed to the virus and not immunized will get it. The virus can live on its own surfaces for up to 2 hours. As well, you start spreading the infection up to 4 days before you even have symptoms. So the symptoms of measles, though, are fairly similar to the flu, with high fever, cough, runny nose, red watery eyes. 2 to 3 days after these symptoms, you may get tiny spots inside your mouth called Koplik spots. Then 3 to 5 days after the initial symptoms, the red spotted rash, characteristic of measles, breaks out, and then your fever spikes. The rash and the fever usually subside after a few days. Now, if those are the only problems that happen with measles, maybe it wouldn't be as big of a deal. But unfortunately, measles has a high risk of complications. Out of 1,000 patients who get measles, up to 3 of them will get severe pneumonia, swelling in the brain called encephalitis, and even death. Unfortunately, the younger the patient is, the higher risk they are of complications. At the time of filming this, with the current outbreak, according to news reports, from the 35 active cases, one of them is already in the hospital for it. Your kids can get really sick from this. Now, the worst part about measles is there's no treatment. The only way we have of tackling this is through vaccination. But the best news about measles is that by appropriate vaccination, it is up to 99% effective in preventing it. That's why in the year 2000, the CDC was able to declare it eradicated from the United States. Unfortunately, right about that time was when a lot of the myths and misinformation started regarding vaccines and their safety. You see, it all started from a man named Andrew Wakefield, a researcher in England who was looking at the possible link between vaccines and some intestinal issues. They wrote a paper looking at 12 different children where it was felt that there may be a link between the vaccine and this condition, and then the subsequent development of autism. In the paper, they didn't actually claim a link between autism. However, in subsequent discussions, Dr. Wakefield made that claim. Well, once this was released to the media, well, they had a heyday with it, and the doubt was firmly implanted in the public mind. Since then, there have been multiple very good, highly scientific studies with thousands and thousands of participants, which not only have shown no link with the MMR vaccine in autism, but they've actually seen the opposite. Several have shown a trend towards lower rates of autism for those who have had the vaccine. Remember, the original study had 12 participants, so compare that to the many years and thousands of participants of the various studies, and hopefully that will help you feel a little more confident of the validity of the studies. Now here's the most interesting thing about all of this controversy. In the subsequent years, as more and more investigation into this has gone on, there have been some disturbing findings in regards to the conduct of Dr. Wakefield. The first of which, of course, was his claim that went above and beyond what the study found. The original study of 12 people did not find that the vaccine caused autism. The second issue was that he started advocating a single virus vaccine, which he felt to be safer. Well, interestingly enough, A couple years earlier, he had taken out a patent on just such a vaccine. Third, it was later discovered that at the time of the study, he was being paid by a lawyer group who were getting ready to sue vaccine manufacturers. Kind of convenient, don't you think? Now fourth, it was found out even later, after somebody interviewed the families of the children that were involved in the original study, that he had fabricated much of the data for the study. So who should you believe? The multiple studies covering thousands of lives showing no link to autism, or a fraudulent doctor who, due to all of this, had his medical license taken away in disgrace, or other celebrity spokespeople for this cause? I'm putting the safety of my children on the legitimate studies. So let's talk about some practical issues regarding the immunization and talk through some of the common concerns. First of all, there's still some concern about some harmful chemicals in immunizations. Many feared that the preservative thimerosal could be a source. Now, this has been extensively studied and shown not to be the cause. And even despite that evidence, thimerosal is no longer being used in childhood immunizations, other than some brands of the flu vaccine that are in multi-dose vials. But good news, even with that, you can still get ones that don't have it in there. Second thing to think about. We get immunizations, and specifically the measles vaccine, to protect ourselves, but also to protect those around us. You can't get the measles vaccine unless you are over the age of one. And certain people who have immunocompromised states, such as HIV or on cancer treatments, and even pregnant women can't get it. Measles in these groups are especially dangerous. Remember what I said earlier about how infectious measles is. 9 out of 10 people exposed will get measles. So please, do what you can do to protect those who are unable to get the vaccine and prevent the spread. Now, the third thing we should address is the fear that maybe I should just wait until my kids are older to get the vaccine. First of all, there's absolutely no evidence that getting immunizations early has any negative effect. Usually it's just the opposite. Remember what we just discussed about how infectious measles or other diseases are. The younger your child is, the harder time they will have dealing with the disease. It's much easier for a body to deal with an immunization than it is with a disease. Now, fourth thing to think about. I think that vaccines are somewhat the victim of their own success. There are certain diseases that we just don't see as healthcare providers. In the 15 years that I've been practicing medicine, I've never seen anybody with measles. See, I see that as a success. However, because of that, many of you also haven't seen it. So the fear of these diseases have put us really in a false sense of security. Hopefully, understanding what this disease can do will help you be a little bit more motivated to protect yourself. So the fifth thing to think about, I've seen more and more doctor's offices refusing to see families who do not immunize their children. This may seem somewhat cruel, but it's important for you to understand the risk that you put other people in when you don't immunize. I have little babies and elderly in my clinic every day, and also those who have compromised immune systems. I can't put them at risk because somebody is irresponsible and does not want to immunize their children. Also, just practically speaking, if I have somebody who comes into my clinic with measles-type symptoms and they're not immunized, I have to seal off the exam room that they were in for at least 2 hours, and likely most of the rest of the day, before they can be used again. Then I have to clean the whole lobby and any area where they were in while wearing a special protective mask. Now that room that I had to close, that's a room that I depend on to be able to care for my patients. Also, do you remember what the symptoms of measles are at first? These were cough, congestion, fevers. How many patients do you think I have come in with those kind of symptoms? Let me tell you, it's a lot and a huge burden on me and my staff if we have to deal with that. Well, there are a lot more things that we could discuss regarding measles, immunizations, and the importance of them. But hopefully this just gives you a taste of why you need to be immunizing yourself and your children. Hopefully you've been able to gain a better appreciation of how serious these diseases can be and how easy it is to prevent them. So please, go get your children immunized. Share this video with your friends and family who may be on the fence on deciding whether they should. You never know when you can be exposed, and you don't want to suffer the devastating complications that these diseases can bring. Well, I hope you found this video to be informative and helpful. If so, I urge you to subscribe right now. Hit that notification button so you don't miss out on our latest content that we put out. This is key to me being able to produce this content for you. So until next time, this is Family Med with Dr. Eric Richards. And remember, immunize your kids. and take care of your body because it's the only one you have.